is it? Because I'm not monitoring from up here.
No.
That was my father in uniform in the First World War. Yeah, but...
My name is Justin Perelberg. Today's date is the 11th of July 1996. I'll be conducting an interview with Andrew Furst, and the interview is taking place in Melbourne, Australia. Before you start going, I'll just... When I asked... could you please tell me your name?
My name is Andrew Furst, F-U-R-S-T.
And what was your name at birth?
Same, only pronounced slightly differently.
How did you spell it?
Spelled the same, but with two dots on top of the U.
And your first name?
My first name is Andrew. At birth it was Andre.
Okay. And any other names you used during the war?
Yes, on false papers I used Furtos.
How did you spell that?
F-U-R-T-H-O-S.
And what's your birth date and your age?
My birth date is the 9th of March 1927, which makes me 69.
And where were you born?
In a place called Nagykanizsa in the southwest of Hungary.
Okay. And what was the closest city to Nagykanizsa?
Well, it was sort of a city in its own right. I can't say. I would imagine a place called Kaposvár, which was larger than Nagykanizsa.
Can you describe for me the nature of the Jewish community in your the place of your birth?
Well, as in most towns of that size in Hungary, about 10% of the population would have been Jewish. And their life was lived around the synagogue and various Jewish organizations, such as young men's club and women's clubs and that sort of thing, the Hevra Kadisha. And as far as I can tell now, there was no contact between Jews and non-Jews at all. When I say no contact, no social contact, I meant obviously my father was a merchant. He had any number of non-Jewish customers, but I don't ever remember non-Jews coming to visit us in our flat or vice versa.
And how did Jews and non-Jews relate to each other in the street, in business and...
In the street? Well, but anti-Semitism was there, but nevertheless, we accepted it as one of the facts of life, and you just lived with it.
In what forms did anti-Semitism take place?
Well... one of my earliest memories would be being beaten up by kids at the playground. We lived in flats, so most kids spent most of their time in the park at the playground. And often you got a beating because you were a Jew. Now, and that was before I even knew what a Jew was, before I went to school. I remember kids punching us, saying, "Bloody Jews, you killed our God." And later, when I learned to read, I remember anti-Semitic, anti-Jewish slogans from one end of town to the other, painted on walls, railings, whatever.
At home, what language did you speak?
Hungarian.
Hungarian. Could you describe to me how your family supported itself?
My father had a shop in the main street, and in fact it was in the building of the Jewish community. And he was a merchant, and they made quite a good middle class living out of it. All the Jews in the town were, you could describe them as middle class.
Could you describe to me your home?
I have a feeling we had three rooms. We lived there for quite a while, but it wasn't the earliest flat that I remember. And it was quite well appointed, with leather armchairs and sort of, I would think, Italian furniture. They were quite well to do.
And who lived in your home with you?
They had a, my parents had a cook, a young Croat girl. Well, when I say young, she was 25, 30, because we were right beside the Croatian border, and there are, were many Croats to this day. And then when I got a bit older, they got a German-speaking governess, because they felt Jewish middle-class kids ought to be able to speak German.
And did this governess, was she a type of tutor for you?
Not really, no. Well, obvious, she couldn't speak a word of Hungarian, so I simply had to learn German to be able to communicate with her.
Why did your parents think it was a good idea for you to learn German?
Look, I'm not altogether sure, but my grandparents spoke Yiddish. Whenever they wanted to say something that we kids weren't supposed to understand, they spoke to each other in Yiddish. They never taught my parents either Yiddish or German. And as I look back now, I think probably German was supposed to replace Yiddish as a second language. And in fact, there were few Jews in Hungary who didn't speak German. It was expected that you would.
Did your father read, or your mother read, German newspapers?
My mother read German because she was educated in Vienna. My father's German was poor, but nevertheless he spoke it all right.
What was your mother's name?
Leah.
And tell me a little bit about her background.
As she was born in a small village, not very far from where I was born, in the same county. And as far as I can tell, they never really lived there. They happened to have a shop at that particular time, because none of her brothers or sisters were born in that village. Her father kept a shop, and as most Jews in that part of Hungary did. In every village there was usually one shop, occasionally a shop and a pub, and both were belonged to Jews. And her father was, her father owned apparently some land, and he found out that somebody was poaching animals on his land, and whoever he caught shot him dead. It was brought to court, and the killer was acquitted. And after that, my grandmother was left with five children and no means of support. There was no social services at all. And my mother was adopted to a sister of hers who was childless. And eventually my grandmother remarried a widower with also quite a number of kids.
What was your father's name?
Joseph.
And could you tell me a little bit about his background too?
Well, My father was born in the same county, in a, again in a small village. Even today, it's in the back and beyond. And his father was a pub keeper. Maybe there is a more polite expression, but this is what it was. But when I say it was my grandfather, it's wrong. My grandfather never did any work. It was my grandmother who ran the pub. And my grandfather was studying the holy books all day, every day, except on the Shabbos when he conducted the services. The services were held in his house.
How would you describe the religious nature of your family, as in your mother and father?
As in my mother and father's generation is a curious one, that religious as my grandparents were, they didn't teach their children much knowledge of Hebrew or Judaism at all. I think at that time it was probably regarded as the new patriotism or something like that, to not to emphasize your Jewishness. There is probably a parallel in Australia, that the disappearance of Yiddish, for instance. And yet, our parents sent us to Jewish schools. It, as always, I suppose, Judaism was in a flux. It wasn't... at the time, of course, I thought it was something set in concrete, but I realized today it wasn't.
Did you have any brothers or sisters?
One brother.
And was he older or younger than you?
He's about 9 years older than me.
Is he still alive today?
Yes, I spoke to him on the phone last night. It was his birthday. He lives in New York.
How much older is he than you?
9 years.
Where did your family go for holidays?
Oh, there is a great lake not very far from where we lived. And as well as that, my grandparents only lived a few kilometers from that lake, so most of the time we went there. Not only holiday times, but quite often on weekends.
What school did you go to in your hometown?
It was a Jewish elementary school.
And what was the nature of the Judaism taught at that school?
Well, obviously I would have to put it in an Australian context. It would be the equivalent of a Melbourne Orthodox school today, even though they would describe themselves as neolog, which meant in the Hungarian context a reform. And that meant that they had rabbis who were dressed like ministers of religion, much the same as in Australia, for instance, Rabbi Danglo. And the sermon was preached in Hungarian, which in those days was quite progressive.
Did you go to any other schools in your hometown?
No, it was the only one I ever went to.
As you got older in your hometown, what did you feel about your Jewish identity?
Not an awful lot, really. We knew that we were different, but there was really no persecution. You may get a beating, you might even get remarks passed on you, but it wasn't dangerous. For instance, on the Day of Atonement, Jewish kids were the butt of every joke in town. You know, as you were walking to the synagogue or someplace, are you starving? You know, this sort of thing. But that's probably the worst. I do remember, though, Easter processions, and that was a time when it really wasn't advisable for Jewish kids to be around. It was a big thing, you know. There were two churches in town, and the procession went from one to the other. And it wasn't really tactful for a Jew to be around, put it that way.
When did your family leave your hometown?
In 1936.
And where did they move to?
They moved to Budapest. And that was really the lifesaver. If we would have stayed in Nagykanizsa, none of us would be here today.
What were the events that led your parents to decide to leave?
Basically business reasons. My father thought he'd do better in Budapest.
And what was the year?
1936.
What did you know about the rise of Nazism in Germany?
Not a lot, but nevertheless, you couldn't shut yourself away from it. Even a kid who was who knew nothing about politics, you know, a 6, 7, 8-year-old kid knows nothing. But nevertheless, the Berlin Olympic Games, for instance, brought it home. And then later, the Spanish Civil War would have been a catalyst to political consciousness, as the Vietnam War would have been to a lot of Australian kids.
Do you remember any conversations at home about what was happening in Germany
at
the time?
Yes. Well, I don't remember them, obviously, just the flavor of it. Naturally, Jews couldn't be in favor of Hitler and company.
Was there any talk of trying to leave Hungary or Europe?
Never. No. Look, there were Zionists around, and Jewish kids who were in Zionist organizations, and obviously there were Zionist organizations, it was discouraged by our parents, our teachers, our rabbis. It was in bad order.
And how did you feel about Zionism yourself?
I was really quite ignorant about it at that time as a little kid. I was really quite ignorant. I didn't know what it was about. I mean, obviously, we were citizens of Hungary and, or to be sure, of Jewish persuasion, but we were brought up to be patriotic Hungarians, and it simply didn't make sense to pick yourself up and go to the Middle East.
What school did you go to when you arrived in Budapest?
That was a private school, and put it in the Melbourne context, well, let's say Melbourne grammar, Scotch if you like, and but that was 1936, 1937, and by then anti-Semitism was really there. It was quite unbearable.
Describe to me some of the incidents at that school of anti-Semitism.
Well, the teachers unfailingly picked on you. And there were some who were sympathetic. The headmaster, for instance, was a reasonable man, but one or two teachers were absolutely rabid anti-Semites. And the children in my class were not too bad because they put all the Jews in the one class together with all the Protestants so that there were four or five parallel classes that were 100% Catholic. And then there was one class, half Jewish, half Protestant, and a sprinkling of Catholics to make up the numbers. So, and Protestants and Jews in Hungary tended to feel reasonably happy about each other. You felt more at home in Protestant company than in Catholic company. And so there was no great problems with classmates.
How many other Jews were there in your class?
I would imagine about 15.
And how big was the whole class?
About 35. 30, 35.
And did any of the Protestant students ever try to defend
you? Yes, yes.
Can you describe any incidents of that?
I remember one boy in particular who always stuck up for Jewish classmates. And incidentally, he was the top scholar, so he could probably afford to.
How did he stick up for you? Was he bigger and stronger?
Yes, he was a tall boy, but he had a kind of an authority about him. He was a help.
What do you recall of the 1st of September 1939?
When well, the first, obviously, when it's, war it's the outbreak of war.
And describe to me the, if you can remember the events of that day in your house or at school.
I can't really describe it for the simple reason because it meant absolutely nothing for us. You got to remember that we lived in a neutral country, and it really meant nothing.
Were your parents nervous that the war would spill over into Hungary?
No. And of course, most people didn't believe that it would last in Hungary or elsewhere. It wasn't of any great consequence at the time.
Where did you live in Budapest?
We lived in the 5th district, which was one of the Jewish districts of Budapest.
What was it called?
Lipótváros at that time, and then they changed it to Szent István, St. Stephen town.
And what was your address?
It was Varman utca 32.
And was that an apartment?
Yes.
Could you describe the apartment to me?
That was a smallish apartment with just two bedrooms in a modern house. And I would imagine a large majority of the tenants would have been Jewish. It was 5 stories high, 1 block away from the Danube, and on each floor there would have been 4 or 5 flats, I think.
And who lived in your apartment?
Well, my mother, my father and myself. My brother at that time was already in the army.
In the Hungarian army?
Yes, well, at 18 all boys had to go into the army, and since he matriculated they sent him to officer school, and then in the course of time all Jews were chucked out of officer school, taken out of uniform, given a yellow armband, and eventually sent off to Russia on forced labour.
Could you describe to me daily life at Varman Street?
There is nothing really to describe. It was quite, a sort of an everyday existence. I went to school, I studied, played chess with my mates, occasionally go down to the park, ice skating in the winter, swimming in the summer. Quite a reasonable existence.
At the church school that you went to, how many years did you go there for?
2 years.
And why did you leave?
I was begging my parents to send me somewhere else. Anti-Semitism was really just too much. So finally they sent me to a state school.
What was the name of the state school?
I honestly don't remember if it had a name. It must have, but I can't remember it.
Was that a Jewish school?
No.
And
it was a state school.
And was there other Jews at the state school with you?
Yes, there were a few.
And was the anti-Semitism less?
Much less, yes. It was in fact non-existent. The teachers were reasonable. our classmates were reasonable, I had no problems.
And how
many, a different world it was.
How many years were you at that school?
2 years.
Why did you leave that school?
I don't exactly know why, but I went to, then I went again to a Jewish school, the only Jewish high school in Budapest.
And what year did you go to that school?
It must have been 1940, I think. Yes, 1940 it would have been.
Do you remember anything about your bar mitzvah?
Not a hell of a lot. I remember the synagogue. It was the synagogue that my mother used to go to, and I knew the rabbi very well. A very decent bloke, a youngish bloke. Most rabbis were old with a long beard. He was clean-shaven, and at state school he was also our religious teacher, so I knew him quite well.
Can you remember his name?
Yes, his name was Joseph Berkowitz. And I believe he was strongly anti-Nazi and put the idea in our heads that we got to watch it, watch our step. And after the communist takeover, he became strongly anti-communist. And he died of a heart attack as a young man.
Did life change for the Jews after the communists took over?
Well, of course, every change, every political change brought its changes in its wake. Yes, of course, it's changed.
What year did the communists take over?
Well, the same as the Nazis, it wasn't... there wasn't a cut-off point. Obviously, the communists came into great influence with as the Russians came, as the Red Army occupied the country. But it took them several years to take over unlimited power.
When did things become worse for the Jews?
Things were becoming worse all the time, all along. And they were tightening up the situation all the time, you know. But nevertheless, it was livable. Until the Germans arrived in 1944, it was quite a reasonable life. But I got to add the footnote there that people who were not born in Hungary or were not Hungarian citizens, they had an awful life even then. They were taken to the border. They were literally chucked out of the country and on the other side of the border, as likely or not. The Germans murdered them.
Who were the non-Hungarian citizens?
Well, look, anyone who whose grandparents were not born in Hungary, you had to be able to prove your residency in Hungary to 1850. And so anyone who couldn't prove Hungarian citizenship was in big trouble. But the Jews who were Hungarian citizens, that lulled them into a false security, saying that whatever happened to Jews in Austria or in Poland, that can't happen to us because we fought for this country and so on and so forth. Our ancestors go back hundreds of years, so we are safe.
And were some of these non-Jews refugees from the
yes,
war?
Yes, some of them were. Yes.
Okay. Describe to me how anti-Jewish laws became progressively more intolerable.
Well, obviously, for instance, as I mentioned, my brother was chucked out of the army, all Jews were, and they were put in labor battalions. And then they made it very difficult for Jews to own businesses in their own name. But of course they tolerated Jews owning businesses under a Christian name. A lot of this was a sop to the Germans, who were pressing the Hungarian government to enact more and more stringent anti-Jewish laws. But they weren't really enforced all that intolerantly.
What year was that, approximately?
Well, from the beginning of the war right up to the German occupation in 44, it was tightened all the time. For instance, there were Jewish members of parliament. Now, obviously, they were chucked out of parliament. And in the end, before the German occupation, even the vote was taken away from Jews. So, in actual fact, the Jews ceased to be citizens of Hungary, but nobody took that too seriously. And it had no effect on us, on our daily lives.
Describe to me the events of when the Arrow Cross took control.
Well, you're a little bit ahead of yourself there, because really before you get to the Arrow Cross, you would have to speak of the German occupation that made it possible. So we lived really quite an idyllic existence in Hungary up to March 19, 1944, well, certainly in comparison to Polish Jews who were being murdered left, right and center. We were going to the opera, to concerts, to theater, on holidays, as if the war wouldn't have been on, and Hungary at that time was still neutral. And then when the Germans occupied the country, that's when the trouble really started. Very soon, within weeks, Jews were compelled to wear the yellow star, which made movement without false papers impossible. And the next thing was that they pressed Jews into ghettos in all country towns, villages, country towns, and within 2 months there was not a single Jew left in the provinces outside of Budapest. Within 2 months, they managed to ship something like 600,000-800,000 Jews to Auschwitz. At that time, there were close to 1 million Jews in Hungary.
Where did you live when the Germans... Did you still live in Varman Street when the Germans
yes,
arrived
we still
in Budapest?
Lived there. Yes.
And did they try and put the Budapest Jews into ghettos?
They never got around to it at that time. They, as a first step, I imagine, they put Jews into Jewish houses, which meant that they designated houses as Jewish Jewish apartment blocks as Jewish houses. The house received a big yellow star on the outside, and the gate was kept locked all the time, and all Jews had to move there. But oddly, Christians didn't have to move out of these houses. Some remained.
So in your apartment block, did that become a Jewish...
That became a Jewish house, yes.
And you remained in your...
That meant that we didn't have to move at all.
Did any other Jews move into your apartment with you?
Not at that time.
Were there guards on the door of your apartment?
No, there was no guards, but there was a janitor who had to open and shut the door each time somebody came or went. And he wasn't really allowed to allow any Jew out at all, except in designated times, a couple of hours a day for shopping or something of that sort.
When your house became, when your apartment became a Jewish block, what was that termed in Hungarian?
Zsidóház.
when it became a Jewish house.
Yeah.
How did that affect your life, just as a child? How did that change your life?
Look, obviously by then we could see that the writing was on the wall, and our elders still didn't want to see it, but young people were probably more with it. I don't know how. You see, what you have to remember is that you were brought up to be God-fearing and law-abiding citizens, and all of a sudden you discover that the law is out to destroy you. And obviously you had to readjust your thinking. I would think that young kids were much more successful at it than older people, our parents, for instance, or the people who were running the Jewish community. They were all for cooperation with the Germans, and if you cooperate, they'll be reasonable. They won't do us any harm. Well, of course, that was absolutely crazy. Now, you ask me how we readjusted our thinking. I knew that in the house I was trapped. I had to get false papers to be able to move around. And a friend of mine, for instance, came up with a scheme to go and join the partisans in Yugoslavia. And he managed to get there.
What was his name?
Look, I can't remember his name. He was one class above me. And if you give me a couple of days, the name might come back. But right now, I can't think. I met him after the war, and he was happy. He was killing Germans during the war. A great risk, but it was better than being taken to the slaughter. And I knew that I have to be able to get out of there, or will be shipped off to Auschwitz, the same as the Jews in the country.
How did you know that the Jews in the country went to Auschwitz?
Look, we didn't really know, but you got to remember that you knew what you wanted to know and disregarded what you didn't want to know. And in a way, I am sympathetic to Germans who say they knew nothing about it, because they knew all right, the same as we knew. Now, I remember American planes dropping leaflets that 600,000 Jews were gassed in Auschwitz, and obviously threatening people. It was a message from President Roosevelt, threatening people with war crimes after the war, that they'll be punished after the war, and threatening rewards for those who will help Jews. And I remember my father and I picking up a leaflet, and neither of us believed it. And there were a couple of escapees in Budapest from Auschwitz who were brought out before the German occupation by the Jewish community. And nobody really believed their story. I mean, you have to think about it, that even today it's difficult to believe. I mean, you know it's there, but that it was there, and it's difficult to believe. I mean, for us, it was better not to believe it. And of course, the Germans did everything possible to camouflage it. For instance, a lot of the Jews from the country, relations of ours, sent a postcard from Auschwitz with a postmark named Waldsee. Now, you looked at the map, Waldsee was right next to the Swiss border. And straight after they wrote the card and they said what a wonderful trip they had, how well they were treated and all that, they went straight to the gas chambers.
How did your family get food after during the Nazi occupation?
I don't really remember, but because there was a war on, we had quite a bit of food salted away. People in those days had pantries. There was no shopping as we know it today. You didn't have to go to the shops every day. They had sacks full of sugar, salt, and cooking fat and that sort of thing stashed away. The daily shopping, I really don't remember how it was done.
And as a child, just as in your life as a child, when the Nazis came in, how did that change what you did during the day?
Well, obviously, when the Germans came, they closed every school, every kindergarten, every university, never to reopen until as long as the German occupation lasted. And we were free to cook up all sorts of harebrained schemes to equip ourselves with false papers and this sort of thing.
Tell me a story about about getting false papers.
It wasn't really as difficult as it might seem. I don't really remember how I got the papers. I do remember getting birth certificates from the town hall in classmates' names. I do remember getting some chemical to wash out ink, which is a lot easier done than it would seem. And in no time at all, you had a whole set of beautiful false papers. And then you went and got more in a false... Once you had a false name, a false identity, you could accumulate one ID card after another. For instance, I went and did a course at the ambulance service. They gave you a beautiful piece of paper with my false name on it with... a beautiful rubber stamp that was accepted anywhere. It wasn't difficult.
What was your name on these false papers?
Furst. That's a good ancient-sounding Hungarian name and not too far away from my own name.
So you were... the false papers identified you as a non-Jew?
Yeah. And you had to learn the catechism by heart, you know... I knew it by heart for the Catholic catechism.
What did it allow you to do, these false papers?
You could do whatever you liked. You could get around, you could go to the pictures, you could sit on a park bench. I mean, by then, a Jew couldn't go to a hairdresser or sit on a park bench.
Did most of your friends have false papers?
Some of them.
And your parents?
No.
Your brother?
No, my brother was in Russia.
Sorry?
But my parents were still living under the illusion that if we play ball with them, they'll treat us okay. No, I didn't believe that anymore.
Did you ever have Schutzpasses?
Oh, yes. Now, that came much later in the piece. That came after the Arrow Cross takeover. When the Arrow Cross took over, now that was in October 1944, you would have thought that the idiots would have known that the war was lost. But then again, look, the way they believed in the wonder weapons coming and beating the Allies, I mean, that was really, really touching in its stupidity. But that's when they started to establish a ghetto in October, November 1944. I mean, you got to remember the war finished within 6 months, and in Budapest they had probably 3 months before the Russians came. They started to build a ghetto in vicinity where Orthodox Jewry in Budapest lived. And it was a kind of a temporary affair with wooden, with timber walls, but nevertheless a ghetto, okay. And then they started, Hungarian police started escorting Jews from the Jewish houses into the ghetto day after day.
Tell me about...
So that's when they set up the international ghetto. That was your original question. to the neutral powers tried to save as many Jews as they possibly could. Now, Wallenberg today is given a lot of credit. In fact, he's given all the credit what all the neutral powers did. They did their best. It wasn't worth a lot, but nevertheless, it was a great help.
Describe to me what happened to your household after Arrowcross took over, after to your apartment block.
Well, as luck would have it, they designated it a Swiss into a Swiss protected house, and at the beginning, Swiss protection was okay, and of course, it made it possible for us to stay, provided I managed to get a Swiss Schutzpass. And I got one, a forged one again, but nevertheless, it looked all right. And it worked. The Gestapo came checking one day, and they accepted it. Now, the next time, because the Gestapo were around all the time, you know, they wouldn't leave these houses alone. And the next time they came, I knew it wouldn't pass, because by then there were thousands of Swiss Schutzpasses around, and I knew that they would come with a list, which they did. And they virtually emptied the house out.
Did your parents have Swiss Schutzpasses as well?
My mother, yes, but my... My father at that time was already Auschwitz. The Gestapo came from for him and sent him to Vienna and eventually to Auschwitz.
Tell me about what happened when your father got taken away by the Gestapo.
Well, what happened was that my father ran his business under the name of one of his employees. And this employee, his name was Wörösch. He went in partnership with the Gestapo. He had a lot of his Jewish friends pointed them out. The Gestapo obligingly came and took them to deported them to Auschwitz, and they divided the loot. In the case of my father, of course, he had the added incentive that when my father was gone, he was the official owner of the businesses. He was okay. And so the Gestapo came and took my father. He told me to leave because then the situation was absolutely chaotic. There was fighting in the streets, air raids. There was fighting between the Arrow Cross and the Hungarian army. The Germans were shooting. Some misguided people took pot shots at Germans in working class districts mainly. And I still remember a German Tiger tank. In fact, I can see it as clear as anything. Standing at the National Theatre, they reduced whole streets to rubble. And I remember that huge tank, the size of a house, each time it fired a shot, it jumped in the air. And in between times, there were air raids, murder in the streets. It was indescribable. So my father said... a friend of his would put me up, I should go and see him. Lived a long way from us, and it took me an even two or three times the actual length of the distance to get there. I had to cross the Danube twice to get there.
Do you remember the name of the suburb?
Where he lived. I don't remember the name of the suburb now. I do remember the name of the street, Düsseldorf, it was.
Do you remember the name of the person?
Oh, yes, yes. His name was Joseph Karlmann, a very decent old guy. He probably wasn't even old. To me, he seemed old. A contemporary of my father, they served their apprenticeship together. And he opened the door when I knocked on it, and I said to him, my father sent me, and my father's name, and he put his arm around me and he said, my dear son, come in, stay as long as you like. I mean, that was really indescribable.
How long did you stay there for?
I stayed there about 2 weeks, I'd say.
Did anybody else stay with you?
No.
And was it an apartment?
Yeah.
And how did he conceal from the other people in the block that you were staying with him?
Well, obviously, I couldn't go to the air raid shelter with him. Budapest had a very well-developed system of air raid shelters. Look, I had false papers, but obviously he didn't want to risk it. And in those few days, not many questions were asked, you know. If they were suspicious, they shot you like a dog. The Arrow Cross would do absolutely anything. The Germans were even polite about murder. You know, these, I can't say they were people, they were homicidal maniacs, you know. They were absolutely crazy. And they didn't need much excuse at all. So we stayed in the flat. Since I couldn't go down, the old bloke wouldn't go down either. But I do remember that his son came occasionally, and I had to stay in another room because his son was a member of the Arrow Cross.
And did you hear any conversations between...
Oh, yes.
What did they talk about?
Well, I heard heated conversations, and I can't remember details, but obviously they were discussing politics and they didn't agree. And if the son would have known... that his father was hiding a Jew, well, without a doubt, that would have been the end of the road, possibly for both of us.
When you left this person's apartment, did you return home?
I went back to my mother, who was still in that house.
How did you know it was safe to leave the apartment?
You didn't know anything. Look, the Bush telegraph was surprisingly efficient. You got an awful lot of news without ever reading a newspaper. The newspapers were useless anyway. And it was safer by then. The situation settled down a bit. And I barely got home. My mother started crying that I ought to go and... because... they called up every Jew between the ages of 14 and probably 60, 65, I can't remember, to... they drafted every Jew for labor. And my mother was begging me that I should go because, of course, it was on pain of death if you didn't. And against my better judgment, I went. And I didn't stay very long. I stayed probably a fortnight.
Did your mother tell you what happened to your father?
Yes. Yes.
Where did your father go?
Well, I found all this out, of course, much later because there was no way of checking it. My father was taken to Buda, which is the other side of the Danube, and kept in a Gestapo prison for a few days. Then they sent him to Vienna, and from Vienna, on his own, with a guard, they sent him to Auschwitz. I often thought that's the reason why the Germans lost the war. Every single Jew mattered.
What did your mother tell you about when Gestapo came to take away your father?
Not a lot. One thing that sticks in my mind, that shortly before they came, my father had a revolver and he dug it in a hole in the garden. And she thought a good thing they didn't find it on him. Indeed.
And why didn't they take your mother away? You don't know why they didn't?
I don't know.
So you mentioned that you went into a labour group.
Yeah.
Who was in charge of this labour group?
The army.
The army.
And it was thought at the time that the army arranged all of that to protect Jews. May or may not be true. I don't know.
What sort of uniforms did the officers wear?
The officers wore army uniform. And you know,
it's a Hungarian army uniform.
Hungarian army. And it did happen, the Arrow Cross were always hovering on the periphery. If they could grab a Jew and kill him, they would. And I do remember there was a lieutenant in charge hauling the Arrow Cross over the coals for killing one boy because he didn't shave, believe it or not, that day. And the army was not in a strong position against the Arrow Cross. Both were armed, of course.
So did you notice a type of disagreement between the Arrow Cross and the regular army?
Yes, yes.
With the regular army trying, did you see them actually try and save any Jews?
I wouldn't say save, but protect the Jews under their command.
Where was your labour battalion working?
It was in a place called Ferry Hedge, which oddly is the site of the international air terminal in Budapest now. At that time, it was just wide open spaces.
And could you describe a day? Or just what would happen in a regular day?
Well, we were digging tank ditches, and they were awfully deep, that I remember, and a lot of digging attached to it. It was just spade and shovel work. And I do remember unloading railway trucks, wheat from railway trucks. That's about all. We weren't there very long. At night, I do remember meeting a lot of people who we knew, among others, for instance, my headmaster, as well as teachers from our school. Just about everybody was there.
Is there any other incidences that occurred while you were in the labour battalion?
No, none that I remember. There, the one thing that sticks in my memory that when the Russians were so close that we could see Russian tanks, all of a sudden gendarmes came out of nowhere and told us to assemble and take us, they were going to take us elsewhere. And these gendarmes had a bad reputation. They were responsible for all the deportation of Jews to Auschwitz, incidentally. And they were. It was one night. They got us marching in sort of rough units. And the one incident I remember was that. They wouldn't carry their own ammunition. They had Tommy guns and a kind of a round box full of ammunition, which was damn heavy. And we had our own rucksacks to carry. So they gave their ammunition box to the nearest Jew in the formation, who was handing it over after after a while to the next one, until it came to me and I threw the damn thing away. I must have been either stupid or a hero, and nothing ever came of it. They were looking for it, they couldn't find it, nothing happened. And they were in a hurry to get to the other side of the Danube, because obviously they felt that the Russians wouldn't stop.
Did any of the other prisoners around you say anything to you when you threw it away?
Look, I can't remember if I would have told anybody, I probably didn't. Because if I would have told anybody, they would have told me not to do it.
Do you remember the month that you were in the Labour Battalion?
It would have been end of October or beginning of November.
Okay.
But perhaps November.
How long did you spend in the Labour Battalion?
Oh, from memory, I would think about 2 weeks, perhaps. And it wasn't too bad. I regarded this as a holiday. The food was good. The camaraderie was good, friends there and so forth. I was unhappy when they took us to the other side of the Danube because naturally I wanted to stay where the Russians were coming. So I didn't stay around. They asked for volunteers. They deposited us in the basement of a brewery. I didn't like the place at all. It would have been about 30 kilometers south of Budapest. And they asked for volunteers for something or other to go outside. And I volunteered, and I just kept on walking without looking back. And I kept on walking until I got back home. As I said, that would have been well over 30 kilometers. And I do remember that when I crossed the Danube, German engineers were fitting explosive charges to the bridges then. Nobody raised a finger, I might add.
And when you returned home, did you still have your false papers with you?
Oh, yes, yes. Well, look, you used the false papers as you had to. Obviously, you needed somewhere to live. And that wasn't easy. It was lucky that our house was a designated Jewish house, even though that had its difficulties, but I fixed it up beautifully so that I could get out of the place whenever I wanted to. And outside, of course, you had to use false papers. Inside, you had to use a Schutzpass or whatever. At that time, as I said, my Schutzpass was no longer any good. I had to get out of the place in a hurry. The way I solved it was, on top of the house there was a lift house, and I could get out onto the flat roof, and I made a key to the lock of our house, our roof. And I made a key for the roof of the next house, which was a Christian house. So I could get out of the place, no trouble at all, anytime, without asking anybody.
And did you ever use that escape route?
Oh, yes, yes.
How many times did you use it?
I think only once.
Tell me about that time.
Well, I fixed up a place when the Gestapo came checking on top of the lift. The lift was stuck. It wouldn't work anymore. And I thought nobody would think of looking there. But for some reason or other, I couldn't get into it. So I got right out of the place.
And where did you go?
I don't remember where I went, but later on you sort of had a routine. Ridiculous as it may sound today, we went to the public baths with a friend of mine. We stayed there for a couple of hours, then we had breakfast if we could get it, and just hung around. The streets were safer than inside, although it was becoming difficult because as time went on, I was 17 at the time, and a fairly tall 17. They were calling up 15-year-old kids into the army, and I was getting worried that I adjusted my papers accordingly, but nevertheless, it was getting dicey.
How did you adjust your papers?
Well, with the method I mentioned, you washed out one lot of ink and put in another.
Did you have any other Schutz passes besides the Swiss one?
Yeah.
Describe to me how you got
that. That was a beauty. Now, that was very close to the end of it all. It must have been January 45. And Budapest at that stage was surrounded by the Russians then near 3 months. And nothing came in or out. And incidentally, that was the reason why they killed the Jews locally. They couldn't take them out anymore. When the Germans had no transport to transport Jews in cattle wagons, the Arrow Cross would start marching them off towards the border, you know, emptying the ghetto and march off old people towards the border.
Which border?
Most of to the Austrian border. And most of them, of course, died on the way. But some did get to Mauthausen that way. I'm sorry, I lost the question.
You were going to tell me about other Schutz passes.
Oh, yes.
You?
Well, it was nearly the end, and there was shooting going around, shooting, bombing, you name it. It was really quite an awful situation. It was bad to be a Jew in Budapest, but to be a non-Jew in Budapest was also no great shakes, because the bombs didn't differentiate. And at that time, there was artillery shelling all over the place, and from every direction. And a friend of mine and myself, we heard that...
Do you remember his name?
Oh, yes, yes. I keep contact with him to this day. He lives in Bratislava, and his name is Strasse, George. And we heard that if you turn up at the Spanish embassy, they give you a Schutz pass. And because the Spaniards were fascists, the same as the Germans, the Spanish Schutz pass counted for something. The Swiss Schutz pass was reasonable. The Swedish Schutz pass was reasonable. Nothing what they make out today, that Ballenberg saved hundreds and thousands of Hungarian Jews. That's a load of garbage. It saved a Jew for a day, but that was life. All Schutz passes worked like that. And in the ranking of the Schutz passes, I would say the Spanish was the best. For instance, the Vatican Schutz pass wasn't worth the paper it was written on. And so we started off to walk to the Spanish embassy, and we had to walk across the railway yards. There was a bridge leading over the railway yards, and miraculously, it was still not a shot fired until we got to the other side, and then all hell broke loose. Mortars. Mortars mean that the Russians really were just a kilometer or so away, because they don't go very much longer, further, but the noise they make is unbelievable. And it puts really the fear of God into you. particularly when you see people going up 100 foot in the air and disappearing, vaporizing. And we did get to the Spanish embassy, nevertheless, and...
do you remember what street the Spanish embassy was in?
Look, I can't be sure. I remember that it was in a little street parallel to the boulevard that was going around Budapest, the Körút. I think it was Bajza utca, but I'm not altogether sure. I haven't been there before or to that day since. And
who told you where it was?
I don't know.
Okay.
Look, when you're trying to survive, nobody needs to tell you any of these things. You know, these things are in the air. You got to have all your wits about you to live another day and then another one after that. So we arrived at the embassy, and outside it was war. Inside it was peace. That was incredible. It was quiet inside. And I still remember sumptuous carpets and antique furniture. And there was a secretary there, and we told her what we wanted. And she said, won't be a minute, and took us into the ambassador's office. Imagine the ambassador himself sitting right behind his desk. And as friendly and sympathetic as you like. And so we asked him if he would give us a Schutz pass. And he said, yes, no trouble at all. It'll only take a few minutes.
Do you remember his name?
I remember it now. I didn't know it at the time. I didn't know that he wasn't even a Spaniard. He was an escaped Italian prisoner of war. And I didn't find this out until 20 years after the war. His name was Giorgio Perlasca, and the man couldn't even speak Spanish. Now, we spoke to him through an interpreter, but I couldn't, at that time, I don't think I could have told you the difference between Spanish and Italian. I'm not sure if I can tell the difference today. And he was really terrific. I remember him apologizing that he was very sorry that he can't put us up in a Spanish protected house because they were chock-a-block full. However, he gave us some meal tickets that we could cash at a Spanish kitchen in a Spanish house. And, well, we parted on that note, shook hands with him, and we thought he was a terrific guy.
What did he look like?
Look, I really can't describe him to you.
Do you remember what color hair he had?
No.
Or how tall he was? Was he fat or thin?
Look, I'd be guessing.
Was he wearing a uniform? Or?
No, he was well-dressed, a beautiful suit. I accepted him as the ambassador. Yeah. Now, what actually happened was that the Spanish embassy packed up... weeks before, before the Russians surrounded the city and went back to Spain. And this bloke somehow or other reopened the embassy and set himself up in business, saved himself as well as must have saved dozens, perhaps hundreds of Jews. And we arrived at the Spanish house to cash his meal tickets. By then we were very hungry. There was no food anywhere. And I do remember that a young Arrow Cross, I honestly don't think he was more than 14, chasing two Jews with a bucket down the stairs into the cellar, because water pressure by then was so poor that you could get water only in the cellar. And, you know, for one second, I thought to myself, I grab that rifle off that little bastard and kill him. But the moment passed, I hesitated too long, and I regret it to this day, because without a doubt, he'd have killed those two Jews. But that's one of the regrets. anyway, that was the flavor of the situation then.
So you went to the Spanish safe house and you had a meal there? Or?
Yeah. And after that, look, we stayed wherever we could, slept in ruins all over the place. It was a very cold winter, so it was no picnic.
Did you return at all to your apartment?
Only at the very end, when there was no more. For the last 3-4 days, the Arrow Cross were bottled up in their house. And they were fighting for their life then, and they left the Jews alone. But that wouldn't be more than 2 or 3 days. Between times, I lived in all, stayed in, slept in all sorts of places, all over the place.
How did you know what was happening to your mother during that period?
I kept in touch with her. Now, my mother was in the best possible racket. She had a Christian friend who lived in a Christian flat in a Spanish protected house. There was nothing better than that. And I got her false papers, not a lot, but enough. My mother didn't look a bit Jewish, so quite happily they could go down to the cellar. Her friend introduced her to everybody, and no problems at all. She was okay.
And she stayed there until the
end?
She
stayed there until the end, yeah.
Okay. Did you hide in anybody else's apartment or house?
Yes, yes.
Can you describe another of those incidences for me?
Look, I remember staying perhaps for a week, 4 or 5 days in a house. It was a suburban type house. On the way out of the city towards the outer suburbs, and an old lady put us up, and
you and George?
No, that was another friend.
What was his name?
His name was Spiegel, also Joseph.
Is he still alive?
No, he's died. And he survived the war, all right, but he died after. And I think it might have been an acquaintance of his, and we were quite happy staying there waiting for the Russians to arrive because it was on the way to the front. And then one day a German engineer came and said that they were blowing up the road right in front of the house and we better get out. He didn't know, of course, we were Jewish. So we thought we better shift.
Where did you shift to?
Oh, God knows. I really can't remember where we went from there.
At any stage, did you witness yourself any roundups or actions?
Oh, yes, yes.
Could you describe one to me?
Well, look, the way it would happen, the Gestapo, with the help of Hungarian police, would come and round up Jews from a Jewish house, from a protected house, wherever. And they were reasonable compared to the Arrow Cross. The Hungarian police, they were not political. The gendarmes, they were mongrels.
The gendarmes were Arrow Cross.
No. The gendarmes were the police force set up, I imagine, originally to terrorize the peasantry in the country. And they had the reputation that they would kill their grandmother if they were ordered to.
So the gendarmes were from the country?
They were from the country.
And
the
Hungarian police were from Budapest?
In the city, yes.
Okay.
And they were reasonable. And look, I remember Hungarian police escorting Jews to the ghetto. I saw that every day. The Jews, of course, would always want to carry more than they could actually carry. And as they were being escorted reasonably tolerantly by the police, they would, of course, drop all their possessions because they just couldn't carry them anymore. Most of them were old. And you know, that's one of those disgusting memories when I see the vultures from the sidewalk moving in, picking up the bits and pieces that Jews dropped. Quite a bit of gloating at the same time. You know, you think they ought to have known better, but they didn't. That was one side of the story. The other side were the Arrow Cross. Now, whoever they could lay their hands on, they killed. And it would happen, for instance, at a roundup of the Gestapo with Hungarian police. The Arrow Cross would lurk on at the edges where the police weren't looking. They would grab a Jew, kill him on the spot. They were much happier walking them down to the Danube and killing them there. You know, that's you could say it's a funny thing that to this day, that's always a problem of murderers, you know, to dispose of bodies. And when they started in this business, and I think, as I said before, most of these Arrow Cross were children of 14 and 15. They would kill them on the banks of the river and then toss them in the river and let them float to wherever. And the Danube froze over fairly early in the piece, so they couldn't chuck the bodies into the water. So what they did was they piled up the bodies in neat piles like firewood. It's funny, we were refreshing our memories with my friend in Bratislava a year ago, and he was wondering the sort of mind who would kill people and then neatly make a pile out of human bodies, three this way, three that way. And without any exaggeration, that pile would have been close on a kilometer long. Can you imagine that?
Where was this pile?
And sort of something like 6 feet high, as far as they could lift the bodies, I imagine. That pile was at the banks of the Danube. There was a sort of a double bank, a lower one and an upper one. It was on the upper bank. And I got to see that pile the first day the Russians came in. You didn't really take a walk down there while the Arrow Cross were still around. And by then the pile was covered in snow, but you could still see the yellow stars. Without exception, they were Jews.
Did you know anybody, or did you ever see anybody who was a gendarme or a Hungarian policeman that you knew before the war began or before the Arrow Cross took control?
No, the only one I knew by reputation was a priest whose name I couldn't remember anymore. Maybe it was Barco, I'm not sure though. He was a priest with a Arrow Cross armband on and with a Tommy gun in his neck, and his business was killing Jews.
Did you ever see him?
I didn't actually see him kill a Jew, but he was in the business, all right. It was easier for them to walk the Jews to the Danube and kill them there than having to cart them there. It's part of the story that he was caught and he was tried. He was also defrocked by the Vatican, and they hanged him after the war.
Did the roundups ever come into your building whilst you were living there in
Rome? Oh, yes.
And explain to me how a roundup would take place when it happened in your building.
Well, on the first occasion, I showed a photocopy of our Schutzpass to a Gestapo officer, and He accepted it with perhaps one question, why haven't got you got the original? I told him, my father has it. He accepted it, no worries. I knew the second time he wouldn't accept it. I had to hide then. And on subsequent occasions, if I was there, I had to get out. I knew I wouldn't get away with it.
And what did your mother do?
My mother wasn't there by
then. Oh, she wasn't there by then.
No.
So you were just living in your apartment?
I wasn't really living there. I was living wherever I could, you know, wherever you could grab yourself a shelter for the night.
Did anybody else ever stay in Varman's apartment with you?
Oh, look, towards the end there must have been 20 people there, yeah.
Do you remember any of those people?
Vaguely. Vaguely. Relations, friends, that sort of thing.
Do you know anything about the deportations that took place of the Jews by the Nazis?
From Budapest?
From Budapest.
Well, their scope was limited by then because there were either no railway connections anymore or Allied bombings were probably effective, or they had no rolling stock, I don't know which. The only deportation from Budapest that took place was on foot by the Arrow Cross. And there was a concentration camp near Budapest that the Germans operated. They deported, they emptied that camp many times.
What was the name of the camp?
Kistarcha.
How did you know that that was a deportation camp?
Look, everybody knew. And that camp became quite famous because it might have been towards June 1944 when the regent regained his authority. He gave out the order that no more deportation of Jews from Hungary. But of course you got to remember all the Jews by then from the country were gone, deported. And Eichmann apparently, in defiance of that order, filled up a train load with Jews from this camp and sent them off to Auschwitz. And apparently somebody tipped off the regent, and before the train left Hungarian territory, the regent sent gendarmes after the train. They brought the train back to Kistarcha, and within 3 days the people were released. Everybody knew it, and that was like a national holiday for the Jews of Budapest.
Did you know anybody who was ever who was deported?
In general from Budapest?
Yes.
Look, all my classmates, because virtually all my classmates. We were going to a Jewish school, and a lot of the kids were from the country. And naturally, in times of stress, they want to be with their families. Pardon me. And so the first thing they did was, the day the Germans got there, they went to the nearest railway station and wanted to go home. And the Gestapo were right there waiting for any Jew who tried to catch a train. They must have studied psychology. They were taken to this concentration camp. And within days, they were in Auschwitz. And virtually all my classmates were deported like this.
Did you know anybody who was killed in roundup by the Arrow Cross or the Nazis?
One friend who was killed by the Arrow Cross.
Okay. Good. Just finish it there. Could you tell me a little bit more about your friend who was killed in one of the roundups?
He was a classmate of mine, 17. A kid who could see the funny side of everything, always laughed. It's just bad luck.
How do you know that he got killed in a roundup?
It wasn't a roundup. He was going home one night, and the Arrow Cross wanted papers, asked him for papers. He pulled a gun instead. He had a gun on him, and they threw a hand grenade at him, and completely obliterated him. There wasn't enough left to bury.
Who told you what happened?
I can't remember. I can't remember who told me. He lived very close to us, and his blood was on the side of that building for the next 25 years. No kidding.
Was it common for people your age or for people that you knew to be carrying revolvers?
No.
Did you ever have a revolver?
No.
Do you remember this boy's name?
Yes, Hirschfeld Yuri.
And do you remember the date that this took place?
I think it must have been in January, close to liberation. December 44 or January 45.
Do you have any particular memories of things that you did with him before he died?
Not really, no. We were good mates. He was good company.
As the Russians got closer, nearing the end of the war,
yeah.
Could you describe to me what was happening around Budapest?
Well, the war, the end of the war was nearing for us, not the end of the war. I mean, yeah. In January 45, obviously, it wasn't yes. too far away, but... for us, once the Russians arrived, that was the end of it. Well, look, there was constant fireworks, and for 6 months we went to sleep with the sound of gunfire, cannons, you name it, aerial bombardments. And you got so used to it that you woke up if it stopped. And... the streets were dangerous because of the Arrow Cross. They concentrated on Jews always, but towards the end they were concentrating on escaped deserters from the army. Of course, people weren't stupid. They weren't going to get killed for nothing. They changed into civilian clothes and tried to get away. If the Arrow Cross caught them, they hung them on the nearest tree or lamppost. The trees on the boulevard were festooned with deserters. And usually with a placard on their chest, that's what happens to deserters. In general, the situation was a shambles. No windows no glass in the windows anywhere. They were all blown out ages ago. No water, no food, no electricity, no nothing.
How did you get food?
I don't know. I honestly don't know. With great difficulty. Look, now that you ask me, I remember... my mother found a bit of flour, and somehow we managed to get a wood-fired stove. I wouldn't have a clue from where. And we stuck the flue out the non-existent window and the house opposite was bombed to the ground. It was a five-story house, but a bomb demolished it. And we got the parquetry floor from there and heated the fuel the stove with that. And then my mother mixed up the flour with water and cooked that on, or fried it or whatever on the top of it without anything. And that was okay, as long as it lasted.
Do you remember any other instances of...
No. By towards the end, food was very scarce.
So what day did the Russians come into...
On January the 18th, 1945.
And could you describe their arrival to me in Budapest? How did you know that that the war was over in Budapest?
Well, look, we didn't know, and we heard Russian spoken in the night, and we didn't know whether it was Russian prisoners of war or Russian soldiers.
Where were we staying that night?
That night I was at home in our house. And, well, it was Russian soldiers, all right. In daylight we could see that there was Russians everywhere, and... German soldiers were walking without any escort to the prisoner of war camps. For the Jews in our neighborhood, that really was a holiday. And the first Russians who arrived, they were really very decent. They had a field kitchen with them, and they cooked Hungarian goulash, and the ritual was that any Jew who went down with a yellow star, the Russian in charge cut his yellow star off and gave him a plateful of goulash. And, of course, it happened that a Jew put another coat on with a yellow star on it, went on for a second. If they recognized it, he got a belting instead of a plate of soup. They were okay. They were really decent. But then, after 3 days or so, the occupation troops arrived, who were absolutely dreadful. They robbed and pillaged and raped and whatnot, and if they could beat a Jew, they'd do it. They wouldn't kill you, but they give you a beating.
So the situation was a little bit better than...
Oh, much better.
Much better.
Your life wasn't in danger. Unless it has happened that people were killed by drunken Russians.
Was there any retribution against the drunken Russians who killed?
None.
Did... Was there any incidences of that you saw of Jews or Hungarians attacking German soldiers?
None. Hungarians attacking Germans, no.
After the Russians arrived, did you see any incidences of Jews attacking any Germans?
Retribution against Germans?
Yeah.
No. No.
And... do you know what happened to the SS and Gestapo? And yeah.
Well, if the Russians caught SS, they routinely killed them on the spot. The soldiers went into prisoner of war camps.
They were the Wehrmacht, were they?
The Wehrmacht, yeah. And the chances are most of them never came back. They took them to camps in Russia. They were badly treated. A lot of them never came back. The trouble was that the Russians were not particularly discerning. They didn't ask for your IDs, ID papers, whether you were a soldier or not. Jew or Gentile, if you were in the age group, they carted you off to a prisoner of war camp. Many Jews were caught by the Russians, Jews who just managed barely by the skin of their teeth to arrive and finished up in a Russian camp in Russia.
After the occupying troops arrived in Budapest, Did you move back to your apartment?
Yeah, yes.
And did your mother move back with you?
Yes, yes.
And how did you find out where your father was and where your brother was?
We had no idea. We had no idea, and at that time, all we knew about Auschwitz was what we read on that leaflet from President Roosevelt. And I remember musing about it and talking to a friend that my father was probably taken to Gestapo headquarters in Buda. From there, they probably took him to Auschwitz. It would have taken so and so long to get there. We knew that Auschwitz was liberated the same day as us, January the 18th. And I thought the old man was a resourceful fellow. He may have managed to survive in Auschwitz. And if so, he should be back in Budapest any day now. And without me knowing, he was already back in Budapest then. He was liberated in Auschwitz. He managed to hide under one of the barracks. And as soon as the Russians arrived, he started to walk home. It took him a month. He was blood and skin and bone, and but he got back.
And your brother?
My brother was taken prisoner in Russia. There was a big breakthrough, and the Russians took the whole of the Hungarian army, the whole army group, as prisoners. And eventually, in the end, they sorted out Jews from non-Jews. But at the beginning, they had nowhere to keep their prisoners. Most of them froze to death. The ones who didn't freeze to death were died of typhus in the spring. And I was told that in the division that my brother was in, there were 15,000 Jews, and three came back.
When did your brother return?
He came back on the Day of Atonement, on Kol Nidre night, in 1945.
And do you remember what day your father came back?
Well, that would have been almost a month, in February then, towards the end of February in 44. And he was the first person that I heard from gas chambers and whatever else in Auschwitz.
Did your father tell you everything that happened?
Oh, yes.
Immediately?
Yeah. Yes. I had to believe it then.
When it was just you and your father and your mother in the apartment, did you know that your brother was on his way home? Did you know that he was alive?
No, we didn't know until he actually arrived.
So what were your parents and you going to do? Did you decide to stay in Budapest, or did you return to school?
Look, I think my parents would have decided to stay there. Whether they decided at that stage, there wasn't a lot of choice, you know. I mean, where do you go? And particularly for middle-aged people. I decided very early in the piece that I had enough. I wouldn't stay there. And I can even tell you the time when it happened. I was already going to school then. The school reopened very soon after the Russians arrived. And there were hardly any kids, hardly any teachers, but the school reopened. And I was going to school, and a policeman pulled me up. He was a policeman who was taking prisoners for the Russians. And it so happened I recognized this policeman as one of the policemen who was escorting Jews to the ghetto.
Was he in? Was he a gendarme or a
hangar? No, a policeman in a police uniform. And you know, when the Russians arrived, I watched the police march past the Russians. The Russians marched them up. The Russians took their rifles, and they bashed them against the pavement, making them useless. So they were not armed. And I recognized this cop, and I called him, I lost my temper, and I called him a no good son of a bitch. You were working for the Germans, and now you're working for the Russians. I said, I recognize you. You were escorting Jews not that long ago. And then he lost his temper, and he said, on your way before I do something. And that was when I made up my time. This is it. This is no place for me.
How old were you at that stage?
17. Look, yes, you know, if you survived that 1 year under German occupation, you were an old man, believe me. You accumulated enough experiences to last you a lifetime. In fact, school was impossible. You know, it was impossible to keep discipline with kids who survived the occupation.
Did you complete your matriculation?
Yes, I did.
And what did you decide to do?
I decided nothing, but the only thing that I decided was not to stay there any longer, no matter what.
What did you decide to do to get out of Budapest?
As a first stage, I thought I'd go to Vienna. I didn't even apply to the university in Budapest. I decided to get out and try and study in Vienna. Of course, in retrospect, it was damn stupid. Were the Austrians any better than the Hungarians? No. I know that now. If anything, perhaps they were worse.
Before we talk more about your experience, what led you to go to Austria, could you describe the day that your brother returned to Budapest and the family, basically the family reunion?
Well, we were all dressed up, as I said, minutes away from starting to walk to the synagogue. And there was a knock on the door, and there was a Russian soldier standing outside. And I didn't recognize my brother at all. It was my brother in a Russian uniform. And my first thought was another bloody Russian came robbing the house, because that was an everyday occurrence. And then, of course, he must have introduced himself.
How many years had it been since you last saw him?
Near enough 4 years, I would say. We didn't even know he was alive in that time.
And what followed after that? After you realized that it was your brother, did you all go to shul together, or did you sit down?
I honestly can't remember if we went to shul or whether we stayed home. I'd have to ask my brother. He would probably remember.
How did you feel when you saw your brother?
It's difficult to put it into words. As I mentioned to you before, I have never, ever met a Jewish family where every member survived under German occupation. Ours is the only one, and it must have been quite something to see the whole family complete.
You mentioned that you were going to shul that day.
Yeah.
What was your perspective on religion at that stage, having gone through what you went through?
Oh, look, that really had nothing to do with it. I imagine if you were a believer, you probably stayed a believer, but the trouble was that in a Jewish school, they pushed Judaism down our throat to such an extent that they managed to turn most of us against it. Attendance at the synagogue was compulsory. Every Shabbos, every Friday night, and there was a roll call, you know, they really put us off. I think that had more to do with it than the German occupation.
And your parents, how did they feel about?
Well, I do remember when my father came back from Auschwitz, I remember him saying there can't be a God, or he couldn't have permitted this to happen. And yet he went back to being a believer again. My mother was always a believer.
So when did you go to Austria?
After matriculation, as soon as I finished school, I got out like a shot.
Do you remember the month?
No. Must have been. Look, the school year started in Vienna in September. I must have got out of Budapest in, I expect, July, August. But I don't honestly remember exactly.
How did you get to Austria?
How do you mean?
Did you catch a train or?
No, I went to Austria illegally. There was no legal way. There was nobody to give you a passport and nothing like that. And I went to Vienna illegally. How did I get there? I can't remember how I got to the border. I just walked across the border. There was only Russians to worry about borders then, and they didn't particularly worry. And I got a local train to Vienna, and I stayed at first with friends of my father's who knew them from way back. And it was in the American zone, and I got papers after a while. Later on, I managed to get myself a Hungarian passport, so for a while I could go back in school holidays.
Was anybody with you when you traveled to Austria?
No.
And could you describe what Vienna was like when you arrived there? What were the Austrians like?
I perceived less anti-Semitism in Vienna than in Budapest, but I was probably wrong. You see what you want to see. And I was also more familiar with Budapest, so I saw more of it. And certainly at the university, for instance, the professors were all old men, either men who retired before the Nazis took over or Jews who came back from overseas. And the students were all veterans, most of them older than I. They were usually men in their from 25 to 30, who really wanted to get on with their lives. They were probably in a prison camp or in the army or whatever, and most of them were years older than I. And Vienna itself was bombed to ribbons. It wasn't much to look at in those days. Food was very scarce. There was starvation for years after.
Was there any incidences of anti-Semitism in particular?
I can't think of any in Vienna. I do remember in Hungary, even when I traveled on train, listening to people talk, more than once I heard more came back than the Germans ever deported. That was common sentiment.
Did you ever say anything?
No.
So when you were in Austria, what was the address of the place you were staying at?
At first I stayed in a place in Bandgasse and then in Neubaugasse. It so happens that was the same street a block further on from where my uncle had his factory before he was sent to Dachau.
And how did you finance your studies?
I got a scholarship from, if I remember rightly, it was from HIAS. But I can't be too sure. It was a Jewish organization at any rate.
an Austrian Jewish organization or a world?
It would have been an Austrian Jewish organization that would have been financed, I imagine, internationally, because Austrian Jews then had nothing.
And what did you decide to study at the university?
Civil engineering.
And how did you get accepted to the university?
No problems at all. None at all.
You just made an application, or...?
Well, look, the system in Vienna was different from here. The entrance examination consisted of the dean having a talk with you for a half an hour or so. If he liked your face, you were admitted.
And the dean had no trouble with you being Jewish at that stage?
None. Some of the lecturers were in the army. As I said, the professors were old. The lecturers were, as usual, in their 30s, 40s, all veterans. And my mathematics lecturer I knew well. He was in the code department, you know, trying to break Allied codes in the Air Force. There were a couple of blokes I knew, colleagues who were SS, who didn't know I was Jewish and told me. I didn't advertise my Jewishness. I don't think that would have been advisable.
That they told you that they were in the SS?
They told me they were in the SS, but they were Volksdeutsche from Slovakia. The ethnic Germans were routinely drafted into the Waffen-SS. Pardon me.
And were they proud of being in the SS?
Look, from memory, they were neither proud or upset about it. For them, it was just a fact of life.
Did
one of them was in a bad way? Come to think of it now, he had diabetes very badly. He said he was in a tank, and the tank was shot up and caught fire, and he had diabetes ever since.
Did they show any remorse about what happened in the concentration camps?
Look, at that time, that wasn't discussed. Now,
was it in the newspapers?
No, not really. Not really. Look, today, that would seem quite outlandish, but you got to remember that Dr. Mengele went back to his town and lived under his own name for the next 5 years, and nobody worried about him. Jews went home, they knew all about Dr. Mengele, and nobody bothered about it. Look, they were too busy trying to make a living. And so for, and as well as that, somehow the enormity of what happened didn't sink in. It kept sinking in 10 years after the event, actually, what we went through.
Do you remember discussing it with other Jewish students at the university?
Oh, without stopping, all the time.
And what were some of the points that you raised with them?
That I wouldn't remember now. But naturally, experiences were exchanged. Look, to be a student in Vienna in your late teens or 20s, you had to have a story to have survived. There was no other way. You were either in a camp or you were hiding. There was nothing else.
Did you discuss emigrating or going to Palestine?
Yes, friends of mine did go to Palestine. My best friend, actually, he's a friend to this day, is in Palestine. Yes, he finished medicine in Vienna and went to Palestine.
What was his name?
Joseph Barkai.
And did you think about going to Palestine?
Never, no.
Why?
Look, I fancied myself as a European. And I didn't like the idea of, in those days, Zionism had sort of agricultural undertones. You went to a kibbutz and you tilled the soil. It wasn't my idea. there were other things that I objected to, such as the use of Hebrew, Hebrew writing in particular. To me, that was going back. I thought that Latin script was efficient enough. I didn't like this idea.
And now how do you feel about Israel?
I'm very happy that Israel is there. If I didn't live in Australia, I'd live in Israel. But I live in Australia and it is my home.
Okay. Were you ever a witness for war crimes trials?
Yes, I did go to some. My father was really obsessed with these trials. Now, it wasn't easy to get tickets, but he always managed. And I went with him quite a number of times to keep him company, and the major war criminals were being tried there, Salashi and company, the Arrow Cross. And on one occasion, my father got terribly excited. He was, Salashi was an arrogant mongrel, you know, and my father couldn't contain himself. He started shouting in the courtroom, and we were unceremoniously bundled out. The police came, lifted up my hand, my father hand and foot, and put him out. And but we were back next day.
What was his crimes?
Well, Salashi was the head of government.
Okay.
And they were trying to prove, and it's very difficult to prove, that these people were really murderers.
And what was the result of that trial?
They hanged them all. Most of them, I'd say.
Were these courts conducted by the Russians?
No.
By the Hungarians?
No, they were conducted by the Hungarians, yeah. Quite a number of Jews were active. The quite often, the prosecutor as well as the defense were Jewish lawyers.
So you only viewed these, you were never a witness in any crime, in any war crime trials?
These were war crimes.
Oh, no, I mean, as in you weren't a witness for the prosecution?
No, no.
Okay.
No. My father was.
He was a witness for the prosecution?
Yes, but I wasn't there then. The man who had him taken away was caught, and he was responsible for the lives of hundreds of Jews. He knew a lot of, he had a lot of Jewish friends, and he took over a private hospital, then encouraged his Jewish friends to go there and take all their valuables, jewelry and whatnot. And when the place was full, he'd called his Gestapo friends and have it evacuated, split the loot. He was also hanged in the end.
When you were in Austria, you mentioned to me that you were involved in some research.
Yes, that was, it wasn't really because of any conviction, it was really a job that Simon Wiesenthal started an organization that exists to this day. trying to document Nazi war crimes. And my job was, in my spare time, to go to the National Library and go through systematically all the wartime papers, Viennese papers, if I could find any Jewish references. And I did this for quite a while. How much money it paid me, I can't remember, but it was handy.
Did you ever meet Simon Wiesenthal?
I can't honestly remember. I must have met him. My immediate superior was a bloke called Tuvia Friedman, who also went to Israel, and incidentally he tracked down Eichmann.
Did you see any of the evidence, or did you research any of the evidence for Eichmann?
Look, I really can't remember.
How did you decide to come to Australia?
Well, look, I lived in the American zone of Vienna, and for every refugee, every Jew, it was open to go to America, no problems at all. But somehow America wasn't far enough for me. I wanted to go as far from Europe as possible. And look, I didn't realize that at the time, but I must have been really badly hurt. I mean, when you consider I was brought up to be a patriotic Hungarian, and surely that must be the ultimate rejection, that they pack up your people in cattle trucks and send them to the slaughter to Auschwitz. And I even considered New Zealand as being, you can't go any further than New Zealand, but it wasn't easy to get to New Zealand, and I had an uncle living in Melbourne who barely got here by the skin of his teeth. So that's how I finished up here.
How did you get papers to come to Australia?
My uncle sent me a landing permit.
And do you remember the date you arrived in Australia?
Yes, it was May the 15th, 1945.
And what did you do when you arrived in Australia?
What, immediately?
Yeah. Oh, for employment.
I went to work for my uncle.
And what was the name of the company?
It was a Rosa Knitting Mills in Camberwell.
And when did you get married?
In 1951, December.
To, what's the name of your wife?
Vivian.
Before we finish, I'd like to ask you an open question.
Yeah.
How do you put into perspective your experiences during the Holocaust with your life today?
There's no way, no way, you know, that you can put it in perspective. That would mean, wouldn't it, that there must be some connection. There is no connection. There can't be a connection. And it was a different world, and this is a different world. Ever since I came to Australia, and that's almost 50 years now, there's been no problems, you know. I've never been called a bloody Jew. I've never been called a bloody foreigner. I lived here happily ever after. And, you know, a friend of mine, almost every time we speak, we congratulate ourselves for having come to Australia. I mean, even today, when you look at the town where I was born, 50 kilometers away, people are killing each other in Yugoslavia. Who needs that? But as to perspective, well, perhaps it has something to do with what I said before, that in this... In the peaceful atmosphere of Australia, let's say a normal atmosphere, what I would regard as normal among humans, the enormity of it all, of what happened there, sinks in, that they were hunting people for nothing more than the blood coursing through their veins that the majority regarded as non-kosher. There was no other reason. I mean, you could say that there'll be an edict tomorrow that every person with brown eyes has to report for deportation to Devil's Island or whatever. There is no... that is the perspective, I suppose. It's crazy. When I look back to Europe in the war years, it's crazy today. How else could you look at it? That the effort and the money and whatnot they expended in killing Jews, that's unbelievable, incredible today, that they would send my father with one guard, one Jew, one guard, all the way to Auschwitz. Can you believe that? I nearly said a fairy tale. It's a nightmare, really. It's the stuff that nightmares are made of.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Pleasure.
I'm Robert, and I'm Andrew's first's youngest son, and here's Paul, he's the middle son, and David, who's the oldest son, and this is my wife, Linda, and my youngest, Ruby, my middle daughter, Alice, my oldest daughter, Hannah. Paul's wife, Margaret's absent at the moment, but he's got his three children here. Kate, the eldest, Lee, the middle, and Mark, the youngest. And absent is also Paul's wife, Margaret, who's in the factory, I think I mentioned that, and also David's wife, Linda, who have just had a baby that's 4 days old now, and her name's Cassandra. That's us, and of course, my father's wife, Vivian.
Robert, could you briefly tell me how you and your brothers growing up related to your father's experiences?
It was a pretty regular topic of conversation in the household. I think all of us were aware of his experiences. We certainly heard a lot of stories. We heard a lot of stories that were factual, and some were very human. And I'm sure that... my brothers and I all remember many of the stories that were told, both on a human level, some of which were inspiring and hopeful, and some of which were just very sad. And stories about relatives, many of whom were lost. I think it was always something we were aware of, that the immediate family survived, something that to this day I still think is being remarkable, given that there were so many families, that there wasn't a complete unit that survived. And, so that was something that came up in conversation a fair bit.
And did you feel it distinguished you at school and at university? Did you feel different to your peers?
Yes, I did. And I think that I couldn't speak for Paul and David on this, but I was always conscious of the fact, going to a non-Jewish school, as we all did, that there was a difference there. And I think always very conscious, and to this day, I'm very conscious of, you know, racism has is a very strong feeling I ever have when somebody wants to attack Asians or anybody else in this country. It's sort of like bristles for me, and I think that my brothers feel the same way growing up in that environment, that it's a bristle on the back of the neck the moment, you know, whether it's Asian or Greek or Italian, that sort of thing, it registers very strongly. And I think that for a generation like us growing up with my father's influence, you'd have to feel the same way about that.
Okay. Thank you very much. And thank you all for coming in. And thank you once again, Mr. Furst.
Thank you.
Andrew.
Yeah.
I don't quite know what you...
Which is the boy you're talking about?
The third row from the front. Yes, from the front and second from the left.
What was? What do you remember about this boy?
I don't remember much about him at school, but I do remember him during the German occupation as the driver of a flash car carting Nazi top dogs. And I remember him giving the Hitler salute.
What school was that?
That was a place called Bolyai Gymnasium in Budapest.
When was this picture taken?
This would have been taken in 1948, I would think. It was my mother's idea that this will be the last opportunity to take as a family. So we went to a photographer and had it taken.
And where was this taken?
That was taken in Budapest.
And did your parents stay in Budapest?
Yes, until at that time they were in Budapest, but they came to Melbourne in 1956. My brother went to America.
And when was this photo taken?
During the First World War, I would think, probably 1915, 16.
What uniform was your father wearing?
That's the uniform of the Austro-Hungarian Army.
What was his rank?
He got as far as corporal, but on this one he's just a private.
Describe this photo for me.
Well, obviously it was taken on the day of my parents' wedding. It was taken in a little village called Nagykapornok, where my mother's foster parents lived.
Do you remember what year?
1917.
Andrew, could you tell me who is in this photograph?
That's myself. When I was 9 or 10 years old, and at that time I used to conduct the kids' services in the synagogue, and always in a sailor uniform, as it was the fashion then, and my mother got the idea to have this.
What year was
taken. That? 1935-36.
Where was it taken?
In Nagykanizsa.
Andrew, could you describe this document to me?
Well, it's my matriculation certificate, and it's obviously a government document with a coat of arms on it, and I noticed it was signed by some government commissioners, but it's also signed by the headmaster, Dr. Raphael Fuchs, and several of the teachers.
What was the name of the school?
It was a Jewish high school of Budapest.
What year did you receive this certificate?
Must have been in 46. That date must be on it, but I just can't. Must have been in 46, yes.
Andrew, could you tell me about the document on the left?
That's my student pass from Vienna, Technical University in Vienna, and the right is a membership card of Society of Jewish University Students in Austria.
When did you receive these?
Must have been in 1946, when I started at the university there.
Andrew, could you describe the document on the top for me?
Well, I can translate it. It says it issued by the committee or the organization for the victims of National Socialism in Austria, and students only. And this one has obviously been issued for foreigners, but I really can't remember for what purpose that was issued anymore.
What year did you get these documents?
All in 1946, that one in 1946, I would think.
Andrew, could you tell me what this document is?
That was the travel document that I used to come to Australia. The Hungarians revoked my passport and citizenship when I decided to come to Australia, and I had to get a travel document from the Austrians.
What year was this?
1949.
Andrew, could you tell me what this document is?
That's my birth certificate. And that was issued in 1946. I imagine I would have needed it for my passport.
Where was it issued?
It was issued in Nagykanizsa. And interesting that the religion still shows on it, even after the war.